hate Evan King.
Well, I remember every little thing as if it happened only yesterday.
I'm an A personality who's made a lot of mistakes. I've been an asshole in my life, you know, and I'm trying to improve. There you go.
I never had a girl looking any better than you did.
Throw that gun out.
And all the kids at school, they were wishing they were me.
Oh my God.
Something's going on inside my ears.
I'm having vertigo.
Sinus drip.
Start sweating.
I'm just spinning.
I'm not talking.
Welcome to touring.
I look like I'm 12 years old, and every reviewer can't get past it.
I can't pay attention to critics.
They give you a good review and then call you a child molester.
They called you skinny skanks?
Yeah. Can you believe me?
Yeah.
Hi, I'm tired now.
I'm stress city, except for I'm happy. I'm positive. The show's gonna be great. Thank you, Dennis. He wasn't one of my favorite, but thank you. I hate them all. Well, I'm waiting for the perfect show.
How's my hair?
Like at any moment I'm just going to keel over and die. Well, I didn't, because I'm proof. I can relieve you from that tension right now.
8. No, I have
determined from watching this film that before now, anytime anybody asked me how was anything, I would always go, it sucked. Oh, it wasn't very good. Now my new thing is, it was very nice, thank you. I never could accept, what is it called? I never could accept a compliment in my life, and I was always embarrassed by them. And so now I'm going to learn to accept a compliment, and when anybody asks me from now on, like I said, it was very good, it was nice, thank you. And so that's my new, because I had no idea that's what I did until I watched this. And the first time I saw it, I kept going, well, do I ever like it? And I'm looking at it and going, well, I didn't like that one. I remember that when we were doing it, when I kicked the trash can, I don't remember why I kicked the trash. I know something happened. The song you didn't see was on Rock and Roll Dreams. And I think what happened is I go for this real high note at the end, and I didn't make it, and I didn't hit it, and it really made me mad. And it was like I was coming right off stage at that point, and I just kicked the trash can. But what's interesting is that I will never, like anybody in the band could make 100 mistakes. And I would just walk up to him and go, it's okay. Don't worry about it. You got a whole bunch more chords to play. Don't worry about this. And so I don't care if they make mistakes. I expect them. But if I make a mistake, it's the end of the world. I'll never live it down. And I go home and I fret over it, not only for hours, but for years. It's like when I was here in Dallas in 1996, I was really sick. And I've hated that show from that moment till now. And the other thing, I know you saw me in the thing wearing the Philip Rivers jersey from San Diego. It's not that I like Philip Rivers. It was a matter of vanity. because I thought that jersey looked really good on me. I really wanted a Cowboys jersey because I grew up in Dallas and I was at the very first Cowboys game ever in 1962.
Wow.
Sitting in the end zone out of the Cotton Bowl with Eddie LeBaron as the quarterback. I don't know how many of you know Eddie LeBaron, but he was about this big. And there's a crowd, like, they went stakes. So the first guy said, well, I want mine rare. Second guy says, I want mine rare with blood on the plate. And the third guy goes, I want mine stuck on the fire, turned over once, turned over twice, and put on a plate. And they looked at Eddie LeBaron, who's about this big, and he goes, all I want you to do is I want you just to run the cow by and I'll grab a hunk off. That's my Eddie LeBaron story. I like Eddie LeBaron. And so, anyway, and especially I'm so glad we have Derek Jeter in our band. And Chasm will never live that down. See, since this has been out, we haven't been back on the road. And we go back into rehearsals in June, and I cannot wait for everybody to go, oh, so you're the Derek Jeter. But anybody got any questions for me? Oh, go ahead. Right there. In the middle.
Do you still have that wonderful wig? And you put it on once in a while just to look at yourself?
No, I never apply. We still have it in the wardrobe case. I'm hoping that it's really moldy by now. You know what? We're sitting back there, and I know we're going back out, and I'm looking at that wig and the end, and I'm going, will I wear that on this? And I'm thinking, okay, I have to come off stage and I have to put it on. And I don't know. So I don't know. Yes, dear.
Hi.
Okay.
The only thing I have to say, first of all.
Okay, the only thing, for those of you in the back that are hard of hearing, the only thing she has to say.
The only thing that's talking about any of that is that I actually had tickets to your first show in New York. We couldn't make it to the second, but it was wonderful.
What are you talking about? She said I had tickets to your first show in New York, and now I had tickets to the second show. I have no idea what she's talking about. Which show? You
the
mean?
The first show that was canceled. I flew to New York.
Oh, at the Garden.
It was canceled yesterday. We didn't get to go back, and I was devastated.
Well, I went back.
I didn't get to go back. But
why not? She didn't get to go back, and I'm asking why. Which guy?
Right here.
The guy.
What are you cheating?
She said you're the only man she'd leave me for. Her on her birthday.
Which of the three,
Bad Out of Health, is your personal favorite?
Which of the three Bad Out of Hells is my personal favorite? I don't really have.
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't know that I really have a personal favorite. I think they're all really good. I really like Batman but that has a life of its own. And it really belongs to the people that have bought it. It doesn't belong to me. It's got some weird name on the front of it. But just before I go on, you have no idea what it's like walking around having the name Meat Loaf. You have no conception of that. You know? People go, what do I call you? Do you have a brother? Yes. What do you call him? Tom. Okay, that's fine. You call me Meat. And then I hear going, I got another little story. I was playing golf. There's a baseball player, a very famous baseball player, used to play for the Angels, Los Angeles Angels, and went to play for the Yankees for a little bit, by the name of Chili Davis.
Yeah.
And I was at a golf tournament in Arizona, and it was the day before the tournament, and we were playing a practice round. So I'm with Chili Davis and a couple other guys, and we get to the fourth hole, and I'm keeping score, and I look up and I go, Chuck, what'd you have? Prank, yeah, okay, three. Chili, yeah, okay. Meat. So it was, true story, Chili, Chuck, Frank, and Meat. So I've always said since then, just call me Meat. Just think of me in the Stu, Chuck, and Frank family. Rufus?
Yes.
He was.
Who in the hell's Rufus?
He's aware
Midnight Special. The only thing the only time I was ever on Midnight Special was Todd Rundgren was on, and we were trying to get on, but Don Kirshner was the producer.
Yes.
And Don Kirshner had gotten really angry with me in 1973 because he was doing a series with a guy named Norman Lear, who was the producer of All in the Family.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I wanted to do the series, but Don Kirshner wanted to own us like he did the Monkees. And I said no. So he got really mad, and he had Don Kirshner's rock concert, which we eventually got on, but he also was co-producer of Midnight Special. And this was only 3 years later, and he would not let us on Midnight Special. So when Todd Rundgren was hosting Midnight Special, he got the video of Bat Out of Hell on Midnight Special. And that was great, right? And I remember it was after a show in Washington, D.C., and we're all gathered around the TV, and it starts, and they've edited it at the beginning, but that's okay. And it gets into the second part of the song, I'm going to hit the highway like a battering ram. And the tape goes, and I'm going, oh God! And then it keeps going, and it comes back to speed, and it plays, and they've edited it again. And then they get to the part in the song where it goes, I'll never see the sudden curve till it's way too late. And then there's a little break, and it comes back, or it comes back, and then I'm dying at the bottom of a pit. Well, they got to that point in the show where they I'll never see the sudden curve till it's way too late. Cut. And there's a woman with blonde hair going. And it goes, Clairol. I had a nervous breakdown at that point. and since that moment, I refused to buy Clairol products. Way back there.
Stand up because I'm a big guy too.
I'm going to stand up because I'm a big guy too, he said. Go ahead.
I sing your music at karaoke. I understand your pain.
You know karaoke is devil worship, don't you? What?
Everybody knows me. Karaoke is toad.
Toad.
That's what?
Toad.
Toad? Toad. Toad. Ribbit.
Ribbit.
Toad.
That's how they,
you know, that's worse than meat.
But the movie was awesome.
Thank you very much.
It gives you an insight of what touring's like. It's something I've always wanted to do.
No, you don't.
But
how old are you?
35, sir.
Nah, you don't want to go. If you were 22, 23, I would say, yeah, you want to go on tour. Because that, you know, it's like it doesn't make any difference. You can be in a station. Well, when I first started in the 60s, I started in Michigan, and we drove. I was the roadie, the light guy, and we had a 59 Buick, a red 59 Buick, and a U-Haul trailer on the back. And I wouldn't let anybody touch the equipment. I set up all the equipment, set up all the amps, set up the drums, and we had a Shure kind of Sun. It was Sun PA, and it set on these little poles, and it set up there. And I worked the. We didn't have monitors, and I would go to the audience. Can you hear? And they'd go, oh, well, we don't hear the guitar. Okay, thanks. And we turned the guitar up, and I had the lights. We had two little stands with four lights on each side, and I had four pedals on the floor with different colors. They were like red, green, blue, and something else. And as the show would progress, I'd reach down and put my foot on the buttons and to change the light. So I would sing and do this. So that's how I got my style right there. What's your question? Yeah, I just gave you an answer.
I work with you someday.
Are you a doctor? because that's the only thing I need all the time.
I have a rare brain tumor that causes me to be this large. I have the same illness Andre the Giant had.
Really? Have you thought about going into wrestling?
I'd rather be in music.
What?
I'd rather be in music.
Do you know, I met Andre the Giant. I actually had dinner with Andre. That's a true story. I had dinner with Andre the Giant. The man ate 5 whole chickens. I swear to God, I've never seen anything like it in my life. I hope you're okay with the brain tumor. And if you do have a brain tumor, you have headaches or?
I did. I had brain surgery once. I'm on a daily shot.
You let somebody open up your head? You had brain surgery.
Whoa. But you've inspired me, given me a lot of.
I inspired you to have brain surgery.
To be outgoing and just say, hell with it.
Yeah, there you go, baby. Yeah. Hell with it. Yeah. All right, right there. You're close to my age, so.
Real close to your age. I got a question for you. When did you figure out that you wanted to be a singer?
I know exactly when that was. I was at a party. In New York, and a true story, I was with a guy named Teddy Neely, who was Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ Superstar, and with his girlfriend named Kay Cole.
Yeah.
And I was doing hair on Broadway, and up until that point, I thought, you know, hey, this is fun, I wonder what I'll do later on for my real life. And so I'm sitting at this party on the Upper West Side with Teddy Neely and Kay Cole, and they all of a sudden want to have a serious conversation with me, which is like, meh. And so they're going, you know, Meat, have you ever thought about like really concentrating and putting everything into this? Because I think you could do something. I'm going, nah. And so they kept talking to me, and as they talked to me, I finally figured out, you know, maybe I should do this. And so it was at that party that I actually decided, okay, this is what I'm going to do with my life. And it was right then and right there. Because I had done, I'll tell you why. It was really based on a character in Hair called General Grant, Ulysses S. Grant in Hair. And the scene in Hair was in the script timed out. This will give you an idea about why I do what I do. Timed out to be about 1 minute and 15 seconds long. Okay? One night on Broadway, I did Ulysses S. Grant for 25 minutes. And they came back to me and they went, that was really funny. But the show is designed to be 2.5 hours long, and people get out at 10:30. We tonight got out at 10:55 because of your Ulysses S. Grant. I said, yeah, that's a problem. I said, it was funny. They said, well, can you just cut it a little bit? So I went, okay. So from then on, I did about 13 minutes. So that's why everything's so long. You see all the songs are long, and everything I do is long, and you'll probably sit here till sometime tomorrow. So that's kind of who I am.
All right, just back up just a little
bit. I doubt it, but go ahead. Certainly try.
Before you got there, as a child or a youngster or whatever, what made you want to... Where did you find out you actually had a voice and you had a passion for it?
Oh, I remember... Wait a second. We were driving down... I was with my mother. And I was over on the road that runs by Luck Field. I don't remember what street that is.
Mockingbird.
Okay. And I'll take your word for it. So we pull up a traffic light, and I'm singing along with Tennessee Ernie Ford in 16 tongues. And my mother turns to me and goes, thank God you're not going to grow up to be a singer, because you can't carry a tune in a bucket. So there you go. You just never know. See, that's why people go, so tell me about singing. And I go, I'm not a singer. And because, you see, I know a lot of people that are singers. And a singer can just walk into a studio or walk on stage and just sing the song. I can't do that. I have to build characters and scene studies, and I go through a whole thing. I have to be somebody else to be able to sing the song. And that, and so what, you know, that's what it is. If I'm myself, I'm the guy, the little kid that's singing 16 tons. And if I'm not him, I'm somebody else, and that somebody else can actually sing.
Two more.
Shut up.
You're very talented.
Thank you very much.
As well as
I'm also a closet stand-up comedian. Uh-huh. Okay, go ahead.
Which is your preference? Music, acting, comedy?
I'm an actor. And that's really what I do. That's what I, because when I was in high school, that's how I actually found my voice as a human being, was through doing the musicals. I started out, they made me do the music. I don't do musicals. And then the next year we did Where's Charlie, and I had a small role, and I kind of got into it. And my senior year, we did a musical called Plain and Fancy, and I had one of the leads. I played a character called Ezra Weber, and Weber, I don't know, whatever his name is. And I did it again. I did it the same as Grant. I said to the young lady who was playing the lead, I had developed this whole thing in my bedroom at home with socks. And I had on like 12 pairs of socks, and I kept taking socks off. And I turned to her, I never do this now, because, you know, you don't do this. If you can get your lines in, go ahead. And so that, I guess I should have realized who I was at that moment, but I didn't. Okay, here we go. We got one. We got time for yours and two more. Okay.
During the filming of Rocky Horror Picture Show,
I have a brilliant memory of the filming of Rocky Horror Picture Show. Susan Sarandon in brawn panties. Okay. What is my most favorite song I've ever sung? It is a song, the last song on Bat Out of Hell, and it is a song called For Crying Out Loud. It is the most believable, real love song ever written. Question. You want it so bad. Go ahead.
Early in the film, there was a discussion with Bill.
You expect me to remember that long ago?
They wanted to get a little information on the old me, and you just wanted to film the fresh me.
Yeah, fresh meat.
Can you talk about that conflict that you had early on?
Oh, listen, you see, they cut that. Because I was really, because when you see that, you go, well, he doesn't look like a very nice guy. And I was really giving them a lecture in there on set, because I couldn't get in my dressing room, so I went in the laundry room. Because I didn't think, I just finished doing an A&E biography. And they went back and they talked to Todd, and they talked to my daughter Pearl, and they talked to my daughter Amanda, and they talked to all these different people. And I said, look, I don't want to do another A&E biography. If we're going to do this, it's about right now. It's not about anything in the past. It's about from this moment forward. And Bruce kept going with me all the whole time. Well, what's it about? I don't know what it's about, Bruce. It'll be what it's about. It'll happen. And he goes, well, what's it about? And I go, well, Bruce, I don't know what it's about. We'll figure it out. And Bruce did. And Bruce did a fantastic job. And put your hands together. It was freezing cold. We were in Canada. Oh, God. And I had said to the managers, whatever you do, do not book me in cold weather in the winter. Send me to Florida, send me to Australia, send me to Brazil. I don't care where you send me, don't send me. So they sent me to Edmonton, Calgary, Winnipeg, Montreal. You see that picture of all that stuff? That's what it was like the whole time, except on Vancouver Island. But Bruce did a fantastic job, even though he had no clue what he was doing when it started. And I was going to give him a lecture. I'm 60 years old, and I know what the fuck I'm talking about. Okay? All right, thank you for coming.
.net loves you.